Welcome on this Memorial Day weekend and on this Trinity Sunday. You will see that you have, I did one of my things. I changed before I thought. Well, so the song that we're going to do first is actually the one that's on the back. It's called Indescribable, because this whole thing about Trinity, this whole thing about what we're doing today is pretty indescribable. All right? So if you would follow along with me.
I'm
most holy God, thank you for bringing us here this day to share in worship, to share with each other, to share with you our hopes, our dreams, our needs, our joys, our concerns. Receive them all and receive us in the name of Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
And happy Memorial Day weekend, and thank you. I'm telling the virtual crowd, too, by the way, that we have people in the room that are, some are decked out in red, white, and blue. I got the white and the blue part, but I don't have red, so forgive me for that. So, Memorial Day weekend, a lot of different things to celebrate that we will talk about a little bit later in the service. I want to thank Jeff for the beautiful music, and so Benedict and Alex and Michael are here, if you can't see them on the camera, and Judy Ward has jumped in as a choir member to sing with them. I suspect that might begin to happen more and more, which is a great thing, and it's good to see a lot of people in the room. Thank you to Linda Holt for being our worship leader. If you're at home and you haven't found your Bible and some bread and some wine or juice for the Lord's Supper, this would be a good time to do that. We're glad you're all here this morning, and let's begin worship.
Rejoice, people of God. Bow your heads before the one who is our wisdom and our strength. We place ourselves before this God that we may be touched and cleansed by the power of God's Spirit. Amen.
Join us, we'll now be singing Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty, number 4 in your child's scale, verses 1, 2, and 4.
Thank you.
now it's time for our children's sermon. And you don't have to be in elementary school or middle school or high school to be a child. I feel like a child here. Lately, I've actually felt a little bit older, but sometimes I feel like a child. And so I want you to think about this, though, children and everyone, children of all ages and the child within us. What are we celebrating on this weekend? Let me answer. I'll give you some things that I think we're celebrating. One, you're probably, if you haven't already done so, you're about to get out of school. I know a lot of people have just gotten out of school. When I was in school, this was about, I couldn't think of a more favorite time of the year, right? It's the unofficial beginning of summer. Some have just graduated from high school or college. In fact, we have a young woman named Anna who's going to, a friend of our church is going to celebrate her graduation in this very room after we worship today. So we're having that celebration, but it's also Memorial Day weekend. And Memorial Day weekend is not just the unofficial beginning of summer. Memorial Day is the day we honor the men and women who died serving our country, fighting for our freedom and for our protection. And as they did this, you have been thinking about this all for the last couple of days, actually. And as they did this, as our servicemen and women who have literally sacrificed their lives did this, you know, they were following the example of Jesus himself. Jesus was talking to his disciples as he said this to him. He said, they weren't just his disciples. You know, that's kind of a big word. You may not know what that even means, but his disciples were his followers, and they were his friends, as he said this. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. Jesus loved us so much that he sacrificed his life for you and me. He wanted to save us from our sins and from death so that we would live in eternity as he does with God. As our soldiers and Jesus sacrificed their lives for us, we're called to live lives of sacrifice. And that may not mean sacrificing your actual life. It could mean sacrificing what you have, sharing what you have, not only things that you have to offer, like toys, but also love. But it could mean that we share ourselves in any way that we can, that we're willing to pour ourselves out on behalf of others as Jesus did. So as we start summer, as we think about what the real meaning of Memorial Day is tomorrow, by the way, that happens on Monday, but we celebrate it during the weekend too. Remember, it's about sacrifice and it's about gratitude. Let us pray. Holy God, we're thankful for those who sacrificed their lives on our very behalf. We're thankful for Jesus who did that indeed. And we're thankful for Memorial Day. And we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. And if you haven't done, if you're here in person and you brought canned goods or food, we're continuing to keep the basket up front. And I don't know if the camera can pick that up, but right now the basket's a little bit overflowing, and that's a wonderful problem. But please continue to bring food for the folks at Bethany. They need that right now at Bethany Food Pantry. For a little while, but every week people need to eat. And so it's our blessing to be able to do that. It's time to move into our prayer, joys and concerns time. And I want to go ahead and just start with birthdays. If I remember this correctly, it's Julia Callison. And she may really go by Julia Gorgeous Callison. But it's her first birthday. One of our church members. And then I like the contrast of what I'm about to say. On Julia's first birthday, Wally Harrison Jackson celebrates his 70th birthday. Just a spring chicken. But happy birthday to my brother-in-law, Wally. I've known you since I was 13. Wow, that's hard to believe that you're 70 now, and I'm only 40. It's tomorrow. Tomorrow is the birthday of Georgia Ann Bauer, unless Tom and Bonnie tell me I'm wrong about that. Am I right? Okay, so your granddaughter. Please tell her we said happy birthday. Suzanne Gonzalez on June 2nd. Billy Tomlinson on June 3rd. Anniversaries, we mentioned this last week, and it's okay to mention it again. It's already happened, but happy belated anniversary to Tara and Russell Nash. And tomorrow, on June 1st, is the anniversary of Ron and Bobby Trock.
May 31st.
Oh, yeah, I'm sorry. May 31st. Tuesday. Thank you, Michael. Yeah, thank you. You know, I'm a preacher. I don't do math anymore. And as I mentioned, I mentioned Memorial Day, so I do want to back up and say, as I mentioned in the children's sermon, it is the unofficial beginning of summer. It's also Memorial Day weekend, and we know what Memorial Day is all about. There's a lot going on, from a prayer standpoint. We're praying for all who are traveling. A lot of people are getting out on the roads. We've had a lot of storms, in case you haven't noticed that. I'm joking. Have a sense of humor when you've gone through some crazy weather like you have, and are continuing to do so. It's funny that it seems to come with Memorial Day in the Austin area. We have a lot of storms, and we're praying for those who may have had struggles during that time and are struggling now. And we're thinking about people who graduated. We're thinking about a nation that's starting to emerge from this time of sequester due to the coronavirus. Dawn and I were walking yesterday on the hike and bike trail at Town Lake, and we literally saw, I've never seen it before, we've walked there many times over many years, and we literally saw an island of people floating in the middle of Town Lake. If you've been in Austin forever, you call it Town Lake, by the way, and if you're newer, you might call it Lady Bird Lake, and that's okay too, but I just want you to know what I'm talking about. It was crazy. I mean, they were almost bank to bank. People are out, and they're excited. A lot of people are in town. This is a destination place. So we're thinking about those things. Another thing I want to mention before we actually pray, one joy and concern. I mean, I gave you mostly joy so far. One concern, we continue to pray for Ernie Fortenberry. And Jeff, do you have someone you want to tell us about?
Yeah, I do. There's a young couple that we raised up in Coleman, Texas, graduated high school with Jenna, Minda and Dustin Spells. And I call them by name because Dustin, who has spent his career in law enforcement, I think is still currently sheriff's deputy in the nearby county, is in his third month of struggling with COVID. He has spent probably over 2.5 months in ICU. He really needs our prayers and some of his men and their children. So I ask you, and they're not the only ones. I mean, we're coming out of this, and I'm so thankful. But there are still those who are dealing with the reality. So at this point, I lift them to you, along with all the others who are having the same struggle. And I pray for God's strength, peace, and comfort to be with them and be with us.
And thank you, Jeff. So we're certainly praying for this family, and thank you for the reminder that as many of us are anxious to get out and be with people, and that's a good thing. There are others that are still struggling, and we've got to continue to keep them in our prayers and our thoughts. And I don't want to forget, so I'll say it one more time. On Memorial Day, of course, which is technically tomorrow, we remember the men and the women in the military, armed services who sacrificed their lives on our behalf for our freedom, our security. And if you haven't seen it, Christina does a lot of this on her own. I love this. I mean, she just surprises me with some of the things she puts in the wire. But she found this, it's in our, if you haven't read our newsletter this week, she sends it out on Friday. It should come to you by email. If it doesn't, let us know so we can get it to you by email. But she's pointing out this week the National Moment of Remembrance that started in 2020, actually, as a nation. On Memorial Day at 3 p.m., we're encouraged to stop for 1 minute, whatever your local time is, so of course for us it's Central Time, and remember those who died in military service for our country. Remember and reflect for 1 minute. I know that's hard. We might need to set a calendar or something on our watch or our phone for that, but I like that. And just check your mind. I will remind you to do that as well. I have a prayer quote. As we move into our prayer time, as we express our gratitude, we must never forget that the highest appreciation is not to utter the words, but to live by them. And that's John F. Kennedy. Please pray with me. Holy God, we return to you on this Memorial Day weekend, knowing that so many things are happening. Some are traveling, some are celebrating graduation, some are excited to be out of school and facing the beginning of summer, and yet others are grieving for loved ones lost in military service, others that are still fighting the coronavirus. And we ask your prayers for all who have been mentioned today, joys and concerns, and we know there are so many more. We ask that you accept this time of worship as our attempt to praise you always and forgive our sins. And we continue to pray as Jesus taught the disciples, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the
The scripture is from Isaiah 6, verses 1 through 8. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, high and lofty, and the hem of his robe filled the temple. Seraphs were in attendance above him. Each had six wings, with two they covered their faces, and with two they covered their feet, and with two they flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." The pivots on the threshold shook at the voice of the host of God, and the house filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me. I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then one of the seraphs flew to me, holding a live coal that had been taken from the altar of the tongs. The seraph touched my mouth with it and said, "Now that this has touched your lips, your guilt has departed, and your sin is blotted out." Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" And I said, "Here am I, send me."
Well, as Greg has said, today is Memorial Day, but it's also Trinity Sunday, which is, I don't know how many centuries, the Sunday following Pentecost. It's been being Trinity Sunday. It is the one Christian, I know you guys already know this because it's so popular, it is the one Christian festival in our liturgical calendar that does not celebrate or commemorate or look forward to an event like we have going on this weekend, remembering all of our servicemen and servicewomen who have given their lives in defense of freedom, the preservation of the values that we hold dear, and to do everything possible to protect their comrades and ours. Trinity Sunday isn't about a person. It's not about an event. It's about an idea, and that makes it weird. That's especially true because it's about an idea that nobody can really explain or agree on, and about which 2,000 years after the fact, theologians are still debating. One in three. Three in one. A unity, yet distinct. A glass of water. Because this is the only explanation I can come up with. Alright? What is water? H2O, thank you very much. We paid attention in chemistry class. Yes, we did. I did too. There's another. What happens when H2O goes below 32 degrees Fahrenheit? What happens to it? It turns solid too. Yeah, right. It turns ice, it turns solid. But is it still H2O? Okay, cool. Well, you raise it above 32 degrees, and what happens to it? Becomes liquid. Still H2O though, right? What happens if you go over, okay, trick, 100 degrees centigrade? Yeah, it boils. What is it? Becomes a gas, vapor. Is it still H2O? So all three of those things are different, yet they're still the same in essence. And that is probably the most simplistic and probably basically theologically wrong example that I could give, but it's the only one I got. I'll hear from one of my profs about that before it's all said and done, probably. I truly have no idea how to explain the truth. So I go to Isaiah. It caught my attention this week because we have these weird creatures called the seraphs who had six wings each. We
with two that covered your faces, two that covered your feet, and two that flew, which is what you're supposed to do with wings. I did some research and I found out that these were the angelic creatures who belonged to the top tier of the angelic hierarchy, which is why they were in the Holy of Holies. They were in the throne room, the place where God sits and where his robes stretch out and touch the edges of the universe. And what these incredible beings are doing is they're singing what amounts to a call and response. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And they're singing this, they're singing a call and response, and it sounds to me like there is no rhyme or reason to the call and response. It is just as they feel moved. And this is a universe-wide call and response that's taking place. Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. Because what else would you do in the Holy of Holies? You sing. And Isaiah hears the song. And he realizes he is way out of his league. Because he can't carry a tune, number one. Number two, he has no place here in the midst of the holies of the holies of God, in the midst of God's own holiness. And he has no words, and he can't sing, until one of the angels brings a coal from the altar of the Lord and touches his lips and pronounces forgiveness. And so when Isaiah hears the question, whom shall I send? He responds with, here am I. Send me. The deal is this. There's a lot of things in this world that we can't explain. And most times when we can't explain something, we end up singing about it. Words aren't enough by themselves. But when you set words to music, there comes a deeper meaning that maybe we can't fully put into words, but which we can experience when the words are accompanied by a melody. Just like the seraphs did. So how do we translate the experience of the Holy of Holies? We can't. When we sing about the experience, we did that today. Holy, holy, holy. We sang that song. And it's about the Holy of Holies. We can sing about the experience. So my deal is the Trinity probably can't be explained, but it can be experienced because, in essence, in reality, it is the reality of God's love in the midst of us. That's what the Trinity is. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. God the Creator. God the Son. God the Spirit that moves and innervates us. That is the reality of God's love in the midst of us. You know, but sometimes we get so concerned about explanations and right interpretations and correct thinking about stuff that we miss the experience of which we're really trying to reduce into words. We can't. We forget about actually feeling what it is that's happening. And that is almost always a mistake. Experiencing a chocolate cake is a lot better than reading the ingredients. Take it from me. I know that. I experience a chocolate cake, and I don't care what's in it. I don't have to explain it. It's good. Jared Bias wrote a book. It's titled Love Matters More. And in that book, he says this. He says, I've heard my entire life that Christianity is about love. But what I saw through our programs and our services and our interactions, what I saw is that Christianity is about belief. I've come to realize that fear about being wrong in our beliefs has crowded out the clear message of Jesus' life and death. The unmistakable emphasis in the Bible and in thousands of years of church tradition, that love matters more. He says, if we don't solve the
Christian culture's addiction to truth, we may miss entirely what it means to love other people truly. We can't allow that to happen. We can't, because if we go down that route, we end up bowing down to what we believe is right thinking instead of living up to the experience of God's love. Peter Enns has written a book titled The Sin of Certainty. And he, in right the front part of this book, he has this. When the dust clears, and in the quiet of your own heart, what kind of God do you believe in, really? And why? That's the question. That's the question we must be willing to honestly answer. You know, we tend to hide behind what Peter Enns describes as a thick wall of proper Christian thinking, trying to get our beliefs just right and our reasons for our beliefs lined out and our explanations clearly stated and our proofs ready, pardon me, for any eventuality, only to find that this has little or nothing to do with why people seek God or follow Jesus. How many of you guys came to church because you suddenly realized those people have right thinking? No. I don't know of anybody. Or how many people have joined the church because you've got preachers who have right thinking? For those of you who are out there and can't hear, they're laughing. Yeah, that's not why we follow God. That's not why we seek Jesus. You see, people, you and I, we seek God and we follow Jesus because of this deep and insistent desire for relationship. A need to be valued and loved and cared for. See, we have within us the awareness of the very real fact that we, you and I, are made from the exact same stardust from which stars and planets and all the wonders of the universe are made. We are many, and we are one. We are one, and we are many. That could be because we are what God decided to do with the leftovers. But I really don't think that that's what it is. I don't believe we are the leftovers of that initial fireworks show. But I do believe that we are marked with a celestial signature, at the very least, that points to the essential unity of the universe and the essential unity and origin of the human race. The universe is many and one. We are many and one. And that's something to think about. And while none of us will ever fully understand or be able to explain this, we can experience a sense of awe when we think about it, and we can act upon it in how we relate to and treat one another in relationship, and how we relate to and treat the world around us in relationship as well. That's why I believe the Trinity is not something to explain. I think explanations are, by and large, quite overrated. What's more valued and more prized is our life in our lives is experience. And I believe that the Trinity is an experience. It is the spiritual embodiment of love and relationship. It is that which reveals the nature of our relationship to each other and to the holy and to this world. So let's start with the Holy Spirit. In Romans chapter 8, and you can live in Romans chapter 8 for a long time if you want to. I love that chapter. But in Romans chapter 8, Paul talks about the realm of the Spirit's work being realized in birthing and in transforming. He says, we groan as in the travail of childbirth, awaiting our birth as children of God. We groan as in the travail of childbirth, being opened and created and recreated and transformed into something brand new. When you think about it, relationship, the nature of relationship, is itself change. It's the creation of something brand new. New life is most certainly that which is created, but more than that, there is also created new ideas, new possibilities, new connections between people and ideas and lives and nature and creatures and ecosystems and on and on and on. And that's hard work. That's the work of the Spirit that we are called to join in. Being created, recreated, and transformed ourselves as we recreate and create and transform the world around us. The realm of Jesus' work, the work of the Son, it was in relationship as well. But his work was more hands-on, if you will. Lifting up the downcast, including the excluded, welcoming the unwelcomed, embracing the unembraceable, comforting the comfortless, healing the sick, bringing light into the midst of darkness, teaching those who have received how to share what they have been given with others who have need. Revealing to us all the nature of God. And the reason behind creation, which is love. The Father's work, the Creator's work, has to be the work of creation and transformation, as well as the work of protection, of direction, of boundaries, not as things which hold us back, but as things that keep us focused on giving life and light and love to one another and to the world around us, because that's what God does. That's what God has always done. And that's what God calls you and I to join him in doing as well. The Trinity is not about an idea to be explained. The Trinity is an experience. It's the experience of being loved. It's the experience of being welcomed, of being filled and directed and guided and changed and forgiven, and then loved more and embraced and cleansed and guided again and changed some more and forgiven over and over and loved more than we can ever imagine. And then being held as we birth new ideas and new ways of relating to each other and to the world around us. The Trinity is an experience of being filled to overflowing with the knowledge of how much we're loved. Not just as individuals, but as part of the whole, which is the entirety of the creation, which includes even the stardust, that may even on this day be creating something brand new and beautiful on a blue marble, a billion light years away. Just as those whose lives we remember on this weekend, just as those lives call us to a higher standard. A higher standard of service and dedication. Dedication to our highest values. So the Trinity teaches us about our relationship with the Holy, our relationship with the rest of creation, but mostly teaches us about our relationship with each other. What matters is love. Ideas and belief, that's secondary. What matters most is the recognition that we are many and yet one. We are all made of the same stuff. And while we will always have our own beliefs and ideas, the love given and love received in the course of life, the relationships forged between individuals, the great things accomplished by regular people banding together to touch the lives of others, those are the things that will likely be remembered most by generations to come. At least that's my thought today. I can't adequately explain, the Trinity, one in three, three in one, a unity and separate and distinct. But in my life, I can feel the pushing and the pulling of the experience of the Trinity upon me and upon the world around me. And I'm willing to bet that you can feel it as well. That's the most important thing. Because it is this that unites us and enables us to experience the wondrous mystery. And it is a mystery of being one, yet many. And as we leave this place, carrying the work, it enables us to carry that with us. Because God's still acting, asking. Who will I send to the people out there? And maybe we'll learn how to sing. Because what else are you going to do when God asks a question like that? And maybe we'll say, here we are. Send us to the glory of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen and amen. Let's pray. Thank you, most gracious God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. In the names of all the holy names of God. Amen.
Like to join us in singing, we'll be singing number 234, Crown Him with Many Crowns, verses 1 and 4.
In the conclusion to his letter to the Hebrews, Paul writes, "Do not forget to do good and to share with others, for with such sacrifices, God is pleased." Sacrifice is the theme of Memorial Day weekend. It's a time to remember and honor the service of the men and women in the military. My memories are of Uncle Jack in the Navy, Uncle Robert in the Army, Uncle Bird in the Marines, Cousin Don in the Air Force, and finally Bobby killed in Vietnam. Each of you has your own heroes to remember.
Let us pray. Most gracious God, we ask you to receive the gifts we bring, even as we celebrate the gifts that we have been given. We thank you for all and for the opportunity to share what you have called us to do. We thank you for the love that you have given to us. We ask you to show us new ways to share it. In Jesus' name, amen. Paul says, I have received from the Lord that which I also deliver unto you. And on the night in which Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. We give him thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples and said, take and eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you. In the same way, after the supper, he took the cup after the supper, saying, this cup is new covenant in my blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread or drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death and his victory over death until he comes. Let us pray.
Eternal God, we come to this memorial table with reverent hearts. We ask you to bless the bread and the cup and each of your children who receives it. May this be a reminder of the sacrifice of Christ, which makes this sacred time possible. Amen.
This is the table of our Lord. It is he who invites all who take his name and say, to come to share the feast that prepared here for us. Thanks be to God for the gifts of God. Amen. Thank you for being here together and for being part of this worship service. Those of you who are here, those of you who are out here. May God's grace, peace, and strength be with each one of us. May you be given the opportunity to experience God's love made real in